Rastafari, this is Wyndham Yan, and we're going to touch on the part two of Hebrew Establishment Ruled Ethiopian Empire, or the fuller title, Black Hebrew Establishment Ruled Ethiopian Israelitish Empire. All right, now in the first part, if you haven't seen the first part, we just basically touch on some basic facts concerning the Afro-Shemitic or the Ethiopian Hebrew connection, right? Because we know that there are some Black Hebrew Israelites that maintain that the Ethiopians are just Cushites, and they're forgetting that Ethiopia is an empire, and that that empire was ruled by the Ethiopian Hebrew, or the Hebrew, the Beta Israel, the Kingdom of David establishment, for which Kedemawi Haile Selassie is the face and the grace of, right? And in order to explain this, check out part one. We laid a foundation. They want to continue right here with the Queen of Sheba, right? The Queen of Sheba and her only son, Menelik, right? From just the title page. And right here we have in the title page, let's see if we can zoom in, right? A little bit on the title page. Here we go right there. Right, zoom in on the title page and continue where we had left off in the previous vlog, in the previous vid, right? The part one. So here it says this. Now this is from the copy of the version that we had of the Queen of Sheba and only son Menelik. What we did was just take a snapshot of it, right? Of the title page. Now we have published, right? We've published, let's go over here. We've published, this is the second, right? This is, let's get that right there. This is the, I think, second or third reprinting. It was published in 22. Let's get this right here so we get some of the basic information. Now, this was taken from manuscripts that questionably, right, found their way into the British, you know, the archives of the British Museum. And Wallace Budge here made a translation of the ancient Ethiopic or the Gutiz language, right? And this was first printed, the first edition was 1922, February 1922. The reprint was April 1922. And then the second edition that was printed or published, you can say printed actually, was September of 1932, right? And printed in Great Britain. Now, British, we know that there's the Black Hebrew presence in England. There was a Black Hebrew presence in what we call England today, or the British. That's where we get the word Brit. Brit means covenant, and Ish means man, a man of the covenant. We'll make that connection as well. The present rulers somewhat being accepted, but we know the Charlotte Sophia and the black blood there, and King Edward, who established the order of the Garter, right? Which was actually a Christian, a Judeo-Christian order originally. Right. But anyway, we know how hip hop was taken from black folks and a lot of other things, jazz and so forth and so on. And the majority of inventions that were invented in America up to the 60s, you know, roughly the 60s, were also taken from black people as well. Let's bring this up again. Right. Here we go again. Let's do this right here. Here we go. All right. All right, so let's read a little bit more of this. So this is the second one. So we're going to compare this one from the second edition. They changed certain key words here. But we're going to read, first of all, the first edition, right? We're going to read what the first edition says right here. So zooming in on this, the Queen of Sheba and only son Menelik, Menelik the first, Kedemawi Menelik, which means who can measure, right? Being, right, the Book of the Glory of Kings. So its proper title is the Kebra Negest. They have Kebra Nagas, but really the Kebra, right? The Kebra, right? The Kebra The K is a K, the Kibra Negest, or the Kibra Negest, right? The glory or the honor, the glory of kings, right? It's a work. This is now the description that Wallace Budge, who received the Star of Ethiopia third class for his work here, Lady Meuks, and a Gentile, a Goy, right? A Goy English white lady, she gets honorable credit for purchasing these documents and getting them out there, because they would be, you know, stored away in some museum or some library if it wasn't for her efforts. So she received the Star of Ethiopia first class, and we, in the new printing of the Kibra Negest, the Queen of Sheba and Son of Menelik, we give her place and prominence for her work. Now some say, oh, she's a white lady, European, but we have to remember what the prophecy says, what Abba Father says. And if we keep doing it our way instead of Yah's way, we prolong, right, I and I captivity. Right? There is a number of the righteous among the Goy, the Goyim, or the so-called heathen, or the pagans, the Gentiles, which will be brought in. This is very, very significant, right? This is very, very significant that we know this. We should put the phone actually on a little bit extended time. So let's get right in here, because going on, you know, that sleep mode and everything. But here it says this, that the book of the glory is called the Book of the Glory of Kings, if it's properly translated, the Kibra Negest, right? But they translated as the Queen of Sheba and her only son Menelik, right? I guess because of popularity, or that's how it would be better sold at that time, right? Now that's the connection, the key connection with Kedemawi Haile Selassie, the King of Kings, right? The King of Israel, the true King of Israel. I, Black Hebrew, African Hebrew, Ethiopian Hebrew ancestors like Rabbi Wentworth, Arthur Matthew, Josiah Arnold, Josiah Ford, all of those who are our ancestors, right? Those are righteous Hebrew ancestors. So many of the modern Black Hebrew Israelites are indebted to those from yesteryear, and we've sought to remind them, because it's them who made that Ethiopian Hebrew connection, and that connection with Kedemawi Haile Selassie, the anointed king of kings upon the throne of great King David, and the rightful king of Israel, because it's through Solomon's son with the Queen of Sheba, David II, that we get that connection, that key connection to our divine heritage, right? To our divine heritage. And it's also the key to I and I inheritance. Let's just do this right here, because phone made that sound right there. Okay, so we have a charge on the phone, right? So we can have a fuller right here. So let's go into this right here, right? Let's go into this right here. Bring this up again, right? Let's go into this right here, and let's read this, right? And so it's called the Kibra Negest. A work which is alike the traditional history. It's the traditional history of the establishment of the religion, the Haimanot, the Emuna, the Imnet, or the Emuna in the Hebrew, the Imnet Bamarinya. So we can see how the two languages, Hebrew is Afro-Shemitic and Amharic, that pure language that Zephaniah, right? Zephaniah 3 verses 7 to 9 speaks of. From beyond the rivers of Ethiopia. Another significant Ethiopia and Ethiopian connection right there. But going on right here, this is a work, right, which is about the traditional history. This is our lost history. This is the half of our story that is not and have not been told, and they have tried to crush this to the ground. But even truth crushed to the ground shall rise again. They have tried to stop the rise of the Black Messiah, the true anointed one, right? I, Abba and Father, and through the Black Messiah, Yeshua HaMoshiach. They tried to stop that in the consciousness, right? The true Christ, right? In his kingly character consciousness. Now, this is an important historical, I call this our Talmud. Talmud just means in the Hebrew teaching. The disciples are called the Talmudim. Don't get it twisted when you hear about the Babylonian Talmud. That is some other teaching that has nothing to do with the true Talmud or the true teaching of His Majesty. This is why the true, the called, the chosen, the faithful Rastafari say, give us the teaching of His Majesty, because we now want no devil's philosophy. So a lot of people know about, oh, the devil's philosophy, Talmud, the Babylonian, but they don't know, right, about this particular document right here. Right? They don't know this half of the story. So let's go on. So one is the traditional history of the establishment of the religion, right? Or the faith, right? The faith, the living faith, the Haimanot of the Hebrews in Tobia, because Tob Eretz is the good land, Tob, right? Tob is a Hebrew word. This is the root of the true etymology of Ethiopia, right? Ethiopia comes from the ancient Tob and the Hebrew, right? The Tob land, the good land, right? And it's also about, this document is also about the patent. You know, when you own a patent, you know what a patent is? And this is speaking now legal, but this is one reason that we perish because of lack of knowledge, right? And this is one reason why black folks are not good with law. Right. And they always have to get the best lawyers that they get is a Jewish lawyer, because they study the Torah. They study these things. We have to recognize who we be so we can return to our glory, our barakat. Right. That blessing that is waiting there for the called, chosen and faithful. So it's the pattern of sovereignty. Right. Of sovereignty. This issue which you hear people talk about sovereignty. This is it. Right. Which is now universally accepted in Abyssinia. Now notice right here, they use the word Ethiopia and Abyssinia. Now one would say, why they do that? They're saying this and that. No, actually, this is very, very correct, right? Because this was printed and published with a sitting ruler upon the throne of David, and that was Dagmawi Menelik, or Menelik the Second. What a lot of us don't know or haven't been told is that when Menelik recognized, right, that there were Ethiopian Hebrews, right, out here in these Western lands, right, he sent a shipload of gold to redeem. And this is exactly Torah. This is keeping with the Torah to buy, to purchase once again, a kinsman redeemer. It's called in the Hebrew a goal, right? The goal, right? The goal is that kinsman redeemer. You have that in the story of Chirut or Ruth, right, in the Bible. Ruth and Naomi and Boaz was that type of HaMoshiach. He was a kinsman redeemer. So Menelik, upon finding out about who we were, right, and many of our people from that time, and we're talking about the late 1800s, the early 1900s, were already conscious. I'm talking about pastors and preachers in the black community. It's so shocking how effective or defective COINTELPRO has been, you know, in the black community with what has happened, that lack of that knowledge. It was in the churches. That's why you have the Abyssinian Baptist Church, so forth and so on. But let's read on a little bit more. As the symbol, right, universally accepted in Abyssinia, Abyssinia refers to the Hamitic or the Cushitic or the Afro part of it. And Ethiopia or Tobia refers to the Shemitic part, hence Afro-Shemitic. Right? Or Afro-Semite, right? As the symbol of the divine authority. Divine refers to who? Yahweh, Yod-Heh, Wow-Heh, He who be, who he be, His divine majesty. The symbol of the divine or I-vine authority to rule. To do what? To rule. So when we're speaking right here in the title of this lecture, the black Hebrew establishment ruled Ethiopian or ruled the Ethiopian Israelitish empire. Remember, empire, how do we make up an empire? Let's go through this again. You have families, right, that form like family clans, right? So families form clans, right? So these family clans then form tribes. Tribes form nations, right? And nations form empires. So within the Ethiopian Commonwealth, there are Hamitic peoples, but the rulers of that Ethiopian Commonwealth, right, are those covenant bearers, right, that represent the monarchy of Great King David, right? The monarchy of Great King David. And here is where we have, let's put this right here. Here's where we have the Haile Selassie connection. Here's where we also have the Lion of the Tribe of Judah connection as well. Now, it says right down here, I don't know if you can see the rest of it. Let's zoom in on it. Right, let's zoom in on it right here. And in fact, we might be able to turn this like this. Right, turn this like this and zoom in on it like this. Right, so it's, so then we could back this out right here and you can see it a little bit wider. Right, so we can see it a little bit wider. Let's zoom out. Okay, right here. Let's go like this. Okay, right here. Well, we'll just move it like this, right? To rule, right? The divine authority to rule, which the kings of the Solomonic line, right? Because David had a son named Solomon. Solomon had a son named David. And it's that David the second, right? Which renewed the kingdom, the Malkut in the Hebrew, the Mengist, Ba'amarinya in the Afro-Shemitic language of Amharic, that pure language that Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 7 to 9 is speaking of, right? That lineage claimed, right? I have to make that claim, proclaim, a proclamation to have received Kabbalah, Mekabel, Kabbalah through their descent right there from the house of David, right? Through their descent from the house of great King David, right? That's the connection. Here we go right there. That's the connection right there. Now, this is translated from the Ethiopic. So the Ethiopic connection is so very important. The Ethiopic connection is significant. The Ethiopic connection is the half of the story, right? The half of I's story that has not been told, right? It's the half of the story that has not been told. Of course, it was known, you know, when we get to recognize and start to, you know, study these things, like even the book that is called The Black Jews of Harlem, you know, also speaks of that connection. Now, I wanted to show you this right here, right? I wanted to show you this right here. Now, well, actually, maybe this would be a little better right here for this view right there, right? So let's... Here we go, right there, right? So we have this right here. Okay, zoom in a little bit more right there, right? All right. Okay, now here we go. All right, now, over here is the new one, right? Over here is, let's see if we, let's see, clear that up right there. All right. Okay, let's see. That doesn't seem that clear. Let's try to clear this. Okay, now let's read this one. This is the new one, right? Now, you remember what it said before, right? Here it says, Queen of Sheba and her only son, Menelik, right? Being, it says right here, being, right? Let's move this like this. Being the history of the departure of God, and his Ark of the Covenant from Jerusalem to Ethiopia. Remember, now this one is actually the first printing of it, right? This is actually the first printing of it. Let's see if we can turn it like this. This is the first, right? This is the first printing of it, right? This is the first, okay, that's a little bit better. Yeah, this is the first, printing of it, right? That other one was the second printing of it. Now, here it says, being the history of the departure of God, right? And his Ark of the Covenant from Jerusalem to Ethiopia, and the establishment of the religion of the Hebrews. Remember what came after the and before? And the pattern of sovereignty. We don't find the pattern of sovereignty mentioned right here in this version, right? Let's see. Yeah, we don't find the pattern of sovereignty mentioned in this version right here. Okay, we'll just keep it like that. You're good to, for this. We're trying this new thing right here. Let's see if we can. Okay. This. to hold the phone and, okay, there we, let's try it. Let's try it like this. All right, here we go. Here we go right there. Okay. Okay, sorry about the little tilt right there. Right, so here, instead, it has the Solomonic Dynasty. Right, the Solomonic Dynasty. Let's see if we can get that a little bit larger. There we go. No. Okay. All right. Okay, there's a lot of words here. Let's see if we turn it like this. Okay, this seems to be a little bit better. Okay. There we go. All right. So here, there's no mention. Right? Here, there's no mention of the sovereignty, the sovereignty. So in the latter printing of it, right? Or in the first printing of it, there was no mention of sovereignty, right? In the 1932, it's very interesting because what made that year or that time different? What made 1932 any different? Well, part of what made 1932 different is the events that took place or occurred in the acceptable year of Yahweh, in the acceptable year of the Lord, right? And we're speaking of the coronation of Ketamawi Haile Selassie, right? We're speaking about the coronation of His Imperial Majesty, November 2nd, 1930 AD. So in the 1932, it says the establishment of the religion of the Hebrews, and, right, it says the patent, the Kibra Neges, is the patent of sovereignty. So in the, remember the video we did a little while ago, and we said that we're not Moors, you know? And the reason for that being, because we know what our roots, we have our roots, we have our document, we have our history, right? We have the evidence, right, of who we be. Right. It's just that the half of this story has been so fought against, lied against, misconstrued, that when we see this so clearly, like as we see this right here, right, and in the other document, let's go back. This is the one right here, right? Let's see if we can. Okay, let's see. Okay, we're trying this new arm right here, right, to hold the, okay, so we have this right here, right? Okay, so we have that evidence right there. You see where it has the patent of sovereignty, right? Now, a lot of this, right, was changed out of the latter, right, out of the latter editions, right, out of the latter editions, right? In the latter edition, right, we have the Solomonic, right? Or the first edition, we have the Solomonic. The first edition, we have the Solomonic. What I'm trying to focus on is that word, the patent, that key phrase, right? That key phrase has been, let's just use by hand right here. That key phrase has been taken out right here. Let's see if we can get this, right? That key phrase has been taken out. I think I might have to, the battery power might be getting, it seems a little more pixelated right there. But anyway, we'll get into much more of that. The fact is that this is the evidence. This is one, right, of the various exhibits, right, of evidence, right, to prove that the Black Hebrew establishment, right, that the Black Hebrew establishment ruled the Afro-Shemitic establishment, ruled the Ethiopian Israelitish empire. Now, in the empire, there's many peoples, right? There's many peoples in the empire, right? There's many different peoples. So some of the peoples in the Ethiopian empire are Cushitic peoples, right? Some of the peoples are Shemitic peoples. Some of the peoples are Kamo-Shemitic or Afro-Shemitic. We as a people, right, even in this diaspora, are Afro-Shemitic people. We need to really understand that. We need to comprehend that. really, really well, because this is so important in not contradicting, right, the prophecy, right, the divine prophecy, and recognizing what aspects of prophecy have been fulfilled and where we are in his vision. Remember, it was the vision of the Almighty. Where are we in his vision, right, at this present time? So I wanted to share a little bit of this, you know, this arm I'm using this arm I'm using, I gotta practice with it and, you know, try to get a kind of a better setup with it. It's the first time we were using that particular arm right there to hold the smartphone, so we can have the exhibits there to show you. You understand some of the snapshots of it, because sometimes there's a lot of information here and there. Sometimes what we do is just take a snapshot of it on the camera phone, and that's good for one-on-ones, or like even in tech school. When we say tech school, like text messaging, you know, seeking to utilize that technology to communicate amongst one-on-ones and share certain key and vital information, right? Explain the half of the story, right, that has not been told, so we can have the full story, right, and the knowledge of that truth, right, we can prevail and overcome according to what is written. There's a companion teaching I want to touch on again when we're speaking about the Black Hebrews or the Hebrew establishment. When we're speaking of the Hebrew establishment ruled the Ethiopian Empire till the time of Selassie, right? Till the time of his majesty. And this is also, there's a prophecy which is in the book that many of us had read from a goy mind, you know, concerning the return of Christ and the second coming. There's much that we have been taught, right, within the Western Gentile Christianity that we now recognize that the word is true, but the context that we have received, you know, and the false images were intentionally to throw us off, right, of the truth, right, and to even get us in some of these mindsets, right, where ones will ask questions like, well, did the white man give you, you know, the Bible, you know, to imply that because we're using the King James version of the Bible, oh, we're using the white man's Bible, right? And that's a simplistic argument, a kind of a circular argument that presupposes you have a very narrow range of history, right? A very narrow paradigm of history. So you're just looking within a small context of history and you don't have the fuller story. So in a small context of history, we can say that the Ethiopians are Cushites, and that is true. Until the establishment, this is what the Kibbutz Neges is all about. This is what the Kibbutz Neges is explaining, and this is what the Kibbutz Neges is telling us right here, that this is a work which is alike to traditional history, right? The traditional history of the establishment of the religion of the Hebrews. So what was established in Ethiopia was first what ones will call Judah-ish, right? Judah-ishness, right? Judah, not Jewishness, Judah-ish, right? As we are Judah-ish or Yehuda-ish. We are Hood-ish, right? You know, we who are so-called American Negroes, right, are Judah or Hood-ish, Yahud-ish, Jahud-ish. And our brothers and sisters from the Caribbean, right, the Jaman, right, the Bane Jaman from the Caribbean. Then we have Levi, right, and we have Issachar. We have all the tribes, but we have a king, right, and we need to recognize the rightful government, right, of the king. And if we study the half of the story that hasn't been told, it will help us with the context, right? Because most of what we know when we talk about Bible is usually from a Western, Gentile, an Anglo-European, and not from an Afro-Ethiopian mind. So we're caught up in the Anglo-European approach to For example, Bible studies, historical studies, racial studies, all kind of studies, right, is based on an Anglo-European paradigm. Because when the scripture speaks about the times of the Gentiles, this is why they seek to stop the rise of the black Messiah. And what we're showing you right here is the root, right? The conquering line of the tribe of Judah. What's so very interesting, and I wanted to save this for another vid, but I want to share this with you as well. Let's just go right here, because we have it open right here in our previous study right here, right? We bring up the Word software, right? And you can download this Word software both at the Resource Center at RTG. That's the Rastafari Foundation, rastafarigroundation.com. And as well as from LOJ, that's Lion of Judah Society, or LOJSociety.org, and click and go to the resource, right? The resource section, right? We'll bring this in right here. So if we can have a little split screen going on over here, right? So we can see what we're speaking of, right? Now here, we looked up tribe, right? I don't know if you can see this up here. Let's bring this down. We looked up tribe, right? So you see tribe right there, right? You see tribe right there at the top, right? We looked up tribe here. Yeah, speaking right there, right? We looked up tribe there, right? There we go. We looked up tribe there. Now, there's 297, right, for tribe. Now, one of the first places we find tribe in the translation. Now you can see we have the Strong's numbers, right? The Strong's numbers are on right there. And wanted to go through maybe a tutorial, right? But if you wanna, you know, check out your view over here, there's a category here of view, right? I think it's under view or tools. It's actually under tools, right? Let's just zoom in right here. So it's under tools right here. If you go to Bible options, right? You go to Bible's options and you click right here on Strong's numbers, right? You click on the Strong's numbers right there. It'll bring up this page, because this will be this page. And you click on Strong's numbers right here. Click on that. And you basically, you know, apply and say, okay. And when you do that, right, these references where you can look at judge is dean, which means a straight course, or sail direct, a dean, a straight course. Because the first entry right here for tribe is in 49:16, right? Or the overt. There's a covert one. This is why I want to touch on this. So here we have Shebet, right? A Shebet is a skion, right? It says a skion. Right, it says a skion, literally, it's a stick, right? It's a stick for punishing, a stick for riding, a stick for fighting, a stick for ruling, a stick for walking, or figuratively, it's a clan. Now that's interesting, that the word for tribe can also mean a clan. Okay, we have families that can form clans, right? But the families will form tribes, right? And now the tribes form a nation. So when we speak about the redeemed Beta Ethiopian Hebrew Israelite Rastafari nation, we have to recognize, well, what is the structure? And this is why the Torah portion, the readings and feedings, and even these videos are to speak on certain aspects, right? Certain parts of the instruction, so we can see the full picture. Right. And we can rotate the image. In other words, it's not a two-dimensional image anymore, but it's a three and a fourth. We're taking to like 4D, right? And HD and the Hebrew, right? The Hebrew definition. So this is like where we're going and where we're at as the Dek Amezamorit. And we have all of this software and technology, right? Where we can redeem the time. Right. Because the days are evil. Right. We're living in the last days of the times of the Gentiles, the last days of this world order, which is also called the times of the Gentiles. So here we have Shebet here, right? So we see that, and you can see down here where it says King James, KJV. Let's point to this, KJV. It can mean correction. It can mean dart. It can mean a rod. It can mean a scepter. It can mean a staff. And it can mean tribe too. But then I remembered something that actually connects with the Lion of the Tribe of Judah, right? Then we remember something that connected with the Lion of the Tribe of Judah, right? Speaking of Moan Besazer Im Negeda Yehuda, because that was David's tribe. That's why the Lion of the Tribe of Judah is so prominent, right, within the Ethiopian history over the past 3,000 years. As Bob Marley mentioned, you know, 3,000 years of history, you know, one can't wipe away so easily. But they have been trying and attempting to do that very thing, my brothers and sisters. Now, let's bring up the verse right here. I'm going to show you in the same chapter, right? In the same chapter, if we scroll up, right? Let's scroll up past the Hebrew right here. Let's scroll up right here. All right, let's go up. We're going through the tribes. This is Genesis chapter 49. All right, let's scroll up more here. We're getting close. We're getting close. Very, very close. All right, we're just about there. All right, boom. There we go. Look at this word. That mentioned that Shebet is the H7626, which is the Strong's Concordance right there. All right. H7626. This is our wisdom. This is Torah. This is our Chokmah, right? Here, Shebet, same word, Askion, right? Skion, you know, S-C-I-O-N, the Skion, which is literally a stick, right? Literally, it's a stick. That stick can be used for punishing, and we find this in the ancients, when we study the wall paintings, when we study a lot of that out of Kemet, and we even see ourselves, the Hebrews, right, even in Kemet, and even coming out of Kemet or Mitzrayim, right, coming out of Egypt, you can see there we have an accurate context for the Bible, right, when we study Egypt. So Egypt is important to us, but our approach to Egypt is not like some of the Afrocentrics, right, which are still on a kind of a Eurocentric paradigm, and they ignore this, the Ethiopian half of the story vis-a-vis the Lion of the Tribe of Judah, right? But now the important thing over here is this word scepter. So the scepter is the Shebet. Now remember, the word Shebet elsewhere is used for tribe. So if we would reread this, let us reread this. Let us see what we have here, right? This verse right here, it says that the scepter, right, shall not depart from Judah. The Shebet, right? The Shebet shall not depart from Yehuda, right? Nor a lawgiver from between his feet. Now, if it was properly translated, we could say the tribe shall not depart from Yehuda, nor a lawgiver from between his feet, until Shiloh, right? Until Shiloh, Shiloh, the tranquil Shiloh, is an epithet of the Messiah, right? Let's bring forward the black Messiah that they sought to stop the rise of in your consciousness. They didn't want you to be conscious, right? Here, let's do it like this right here. Let's put this picture right over here. They didn't want you to be conscious, right, of the black Messiah. Right? They didn't want you to be conscious of the black Messiah. They want you to stay in a COINTELPRO state of unconsciousness. So when we're speaking about Shiloh, right? When we're speaking about Shiloh, right? In fact, let's put that picture back over there. I want to be able to kind of split the screen over here, right? And let's make this a little bit larger right here, right? The half of the story that hasn't been told, right? All the lies that they have spread, right? And many of us were almost tempted to believe right, a lot of these lies that they have spread against Kedemawi Haile Selassie. And many of us went to study it and to search it out. Okay, this is good right there. To study it and to search it out. And we were so shocked at what we really found, right? And this is what brought us from our being Hebrew Israelites, right, in our consciousness, just on the level that many of y'all and many others are Hebrew Israelites, to really recognizing that Ethiopian Hebrew half of the story, that Ethiopian Hebrew connection. Let's read over this verse one more time from the top, now that we have a better setup right here. So this is Genesis or Bereshit, right? Bereshit 49 verse 10. Now we've touched on Shebet, right? Shebet, the H 7626 word. Mm-hmm. Shebet. In fact, change the Chokmah down there and let's put Shebet at the bottom right there. So we have Shebet right here. So you can see Shebet right there. All right, now why is Shebet, why is that important? It's important because the Shebet or the scepter, which was returned to Ethiopia, the Shebet was returned to Ethiopia by the Duke of Gloucester. That's the real reason why they make this movie about this English prince who becomes so-called ineligible to be king because he married an American divorcee. That's the narrative, right? That's the story, right? That's the story that they give you, taking you away from the real story. Because the real story would put your eyes on His Majesty. The real story will connect the half of the story that you wasn't told. And will make you recognize our woe. It is true. Haile Selassie is the conquering lion of the tribe of Judah. It is true. Haile Selassie is the elect of God, the elect of Hashem. It is true. Haile Selassie is the king of kings of Ethiopia. It is true. Haile Selassie is the king of Israel upon the throne of David. Now, with all of that being true, let's recognize where we're at right now, right? Let's recognize where we're at and what is the missing piece in our resurrection and ascension, right? The rise of the body, right? The corporate body of HaMoshiach, right? The corporate body of Christ, which includes, right, the spiritual, the true Israelites, who are not just Israelites in flesh, but are also Israelites in spirit, and those among the Gentiles that are called, right, by His name and by His new name, Rastafari. And we have that within the scriptures. We just read that in the first part of this series, from Amos chapter 9:11. Right, chapter 9:11 to verse 12, 11 and 12, but we also touched on 9 and 7. Are ye not as the children of the Bani Kushim, right, the children of the Ethiopians to me, O children of Israel? Now, some Hebrew Israelites will tell you, well, this only means that the Ethiopians are black, right? And not white as the black Hebrews or the Hebrews, the Ethiopian Hebrews over here. Now that's the residue, the residual of COINTELPRO. That's the residual interference of their interfering, right, in what we should have already known, what our ancestors should have already known, but did not know, right, because of miseducation, because of the religious apostasy, right, because of the idol shepherds that have been put into the churches, right? At one time in the 1930s, most of the documents we find really testify that many of the pastors and the preachers from the 1920s and 30s, there before and even a little bit thereafter, had made that connection in the Bible to say that, yes, we are the children of Israel. That doctrine, that teaching was being taught, right, from the pulpits of black churches at one time. But then we have the whole Margaret Sanger, then we have the COINTELPRO, then we have the stopping of the rise of the black Messiah. And when we showed you earlier concerning the Kibbutz Negest and what's written there, and how in the first volume of it, it didn't mention the pattern of sovereignty, right? But in the second one that came out in 1932, which is 2 years after, right, the coronation, right, the coronation of Moshiach, Messiah ben David, right? Kedemawi Hala Selassie is Messiah ben David, as Yeshua HaMoshiach, as the Bain HaElohim is Moshiach Bain Yosef. Let's recognize that right there, right? There were aspects of the prophecy that the Jews or the Judeans of that time thought, you know, a very good movie that, you know, that I'm going to recommend here again is The Color of the Cross, right? Part one and part two, right? Or movie one and movie two. We didn't even know there was a movie two. Later on, we were put on to that there's a movie two. There's Color of the Cross. Because that, of all the movies that I've seen, it touches on certain aspects, right, of the Bible story that most of y'all who have gone to church and Sunday school and everything have not been taught, that if you knew, you would have a new view to everything that's happening around you and even much that's happening within you, my brothers and sisters. But here it says that the scepter shall not depart. So the scepter was returned to Ethiopia, right, in 1930 and given to Kedemawi Haile Selassie. It shall not depart from Yehuda, nor a lawgiver from between his feet until Shiloh. Now, Shiloh right here, what does it say right here? It says that Shiloh is an epitaph of the Messiah, and it's said to mean tranquil, right? Tranquil. It also can mean he to whom it belongs, right? The rightful ruler, right? This is why 72 nations, and the number 72 is very important in the book of Hanok and the book of Enoch, but there were 72 nations, right, of the world. We're not talking about only European nations. Let's make that very clear, right? And many monarchies, right, that were there, many potentates. And then afterward, His Majesty will prove that he is, right, that only potentate that Timothy speaks of. He is manifesting the fullness of Yeshua's own prophecy concerning the Son of Man, right? The Son of Man, right? And the Spirit of Truth, right? That would testify to the world, right? And testify and reprove them, right? And it says that until Shiloh come, and to him, notice what it says right there, to him, to His Imperial Majesty, shall the gathering of the people be. And I will submit this as well. Until, right, the lost sheep in whatever camps or denomination, whether they want to call themselves Egyptians or Kemites or, you know, Africans or, you know, this kind of a Hebrew Israelite or that kind of a Hebrew Israelite or this kind of a Rasta or that kind of Rasta. In my father's house, the word says there are many mansions, right? In my father's house. So when we're speaking about Zion, Sion, we're speaking of the monarchy of David. I've said this before. We've taught on this. We've presented facts and evidence, and we'd like to even teach on that again because it's important for us to understand the connection of Sion, or what you call Zion, with the monarchy and the reestablishment of the monarchy of David, the monarchy of great King David, right? And there's another pic over here. Let's see if we can show this one here as well. I think it's behind this one, right? It's behind this one. Let us get this one right here and show you this as well, right? This is also very, very important to understand these facts, right? Let's do it like this. Let's do it like that. And let's bring this over here like that, right? And then let's do this like that. Let's see, clear that. Okay, so let's do this like that. How about that right there? All right, bring it out a little bit. Okay, here we go right there. All right, now it says right here, so let's zoom in on this. Does Haile Selassie look like the typical European Jew? Does he look like your typecast, your Hollywood type of Jew? Right? Does he? Right? He happens, right? And it's very important that he happens to have or happens to be who he be, a direct descendant or in the direct lineage to King Solomon or Solomon, right? And the Queen of Sheba through that man child, through Ibn Hakim, through Baina Lechem, right? Through Dawit II. That was his name that he was known as in Israel when he came for his bar mitzvah. And who told us that Menelik came for a bar mitzvah? Well, it was none other, right, than Rabbi Wentworth Arthur Matthew in the book that every Hebrew, right, the book that every Hebrew, black Hebrew Israelite should read. In fact, maybe we're going to do that as a video too. Others can also share in this co-labor as well. Pick up on some of these themes and do your own videos and do your own blogs as well, or just help to retweet and reshare these videos on your Facebook, tweet them out, you understand? Do MASH videos, download them, put them with other videos. Disseminate, right? Sow the seed, sow the good seed of the good news, right? Of Zion's King, right? Of Zion's King upon the throne of great King David. This is why it says right there that he happens to have a direct lineage to King Solomon and the Queen of Sheba, whom Yeshua HaMoshiach gives a prophetic of. He says that no sign will be given, right? No sign will be given to that generation other than the sign of Jonah on the one hand. And then on the other hand, he added to that concerning the Queen of the South, that the Queen of the South shall rise up in judgment with this generation because she came from the uttermost parts of the land, right? She came from the South, right? To hear the wisdom of Solomon, right? Or Solomon, right? Shlomo, right? And a greater than Solomon, than Shlomo has come. And this greater than Solomon is I and I, Godfather and King of Kings, Ketamawi Haile Selassie, the conquering lion of the tribe of Judah, representing the original Jews, or we the black Hebrews, or even better, we the Judah-ish, right? The Judah, the Yehuda-ish people, right? The Yehuda-ish people. And this is why Ethiopia, or I like to say old Ethiopia, because there's some new thing, well, nothing new really, but there's some other stuff going on right now. Because, and it's only going on because many of y'all are refusing, right, to receive the half of the story. The keys are actually in our hands. The keys to the kingdom, my brothers and sisters, are in our hands. But if we refuse the truth, right, then we're not free, right? If we refuse the truth, then we're not free, right? You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Now, I know there'll be some that will try to debate this, but bring your evidence, you know, not try to misinterpret the Bible or the scriptures. You know, we have to be precept upon precept, line upon line, right? So come correct, you know, because this truth right here, so far, none of y'all have been saying anything. All y'all say is some old twisted, you know, Anglo-European satanic CBGB kind of rumors there, which is all part of the COINTELPRO. So the war against his majesty that seems to be in the so-called some elements of the consciousness community and some areas of the so-called black Hebrew Israelite community, this is all a part of the residuals, right, of stopping and seeking to stop the rise of the Black Messiah. It's very clear what Genesis 49, right, what Genesis 49 is saying right here, ain't it? Right? Let's just read this one more time. And this is actually, I think, probably maybe one of the first usages of tribe right here. But it's actually kind of hidden under the word Shebet or Shebet. It's not the soft teh, but it's the teh. And we learn that from learning our Ethiopic gutters. So we have a proper pointing of the Hebrew. Yes, we've gotten certain scriptures, the Masoretic, Textus Receptus, but there's another version that's not the King James Version, right? Because out of Africa came the Genet Eden, or the Garden of Eden. So here it says that the scepter or the Shebet, a skion, a stick for punishing, a stick for riding, a stick for fighting, a stick for ruling, a stick for walking, or figuratively a clan, correction, dart, rod, scepter, staff, tribe, shall not depart from Yehuda, nor a lawgiver from between his feet until Shiloh, which is an epitaph of the Messiah, right? An epitaph for the Messiah, until the Messiah, in other words, the Black Messiah come, and to him, to H-I-M, to his Imperial Majesty, shall the gathering of the people be. And if the right, as Am is the people or the congregated unit. Let's zoom in on that. I want the people to see that right there. Right, the Am. Right, there we go right there. The Am. There we go. The Am. You can see the Am right there. The Am. It says the Am is a congregated unit. Right, a unit that is congregated. Machibar is a society. Right. A congregated unit, specifically a tribe as those of Israel, right? The Beta Israel, the Beta Man, the Beta Woman, the redeemed Beta Ethiopian Hebrew Israelite, Rastafari nation. Hence, collectively is of troops or attendants. So we have troops and attendants. In the figurative sense, it is a flock. Right. And that's from the H, the Hebrew 5971. So you can look it up. It's the arm, right? The arm, not the arm, but the arm, right? Figuratively, it's a flock. Now, in King James Version of the Bible, right? In the King James Version of the Bible, we have this right here. It's folk. It could be folk. So sometimes arm will be translated in King James as folk, as men. Sometimes arm will be translated as nation. Sometimes arm will be translated according to the definition here correctly as people, right? Unto the gathering of the people be. So if the people, right, if the lost sheep of the Beta Israel, right, do not gather, right, to his majesty in spirit and in truth, right, and in his name, then there will be no gathering. No gathering will be. So what a responsibility on those of I and I as called, chosen, and faithful Rastafari in this ministry of the good news of the King of Kings, right? Because it says that everywhere will the gospel, right, or the good news, the Bishara in the Hebrew, the Bishrat, or the Mishrach, right, the Bishrach, the Mishrach, or in the Hebrew, the Bishara, Wengel, good news, gospel, the good news of the King of Kings in Christ be preached, be proclaimed, and then the end, right? The end of what? The end of the times of the Gentiles will come, right? It's not by force, right? It's not by might, as the Navim says, and the Beam, the prophet said, in the Bi, it's but by my spirit, right? And therefore it must be within spirit and in truth. So this is the second part, right? And perhaps If Yah wills, maybe this can be more of a series and build up on it. But the fact is that the Black Hebrew establishment, right, ruled the Ethiopian Israelitish Empire. And Kedamawi Haile Selassie is the sign and the seal, right, of the second coming of Yeshua HaMoshiach, right? But there is a third advent, right? That third advent is the advent that is beginning and now ongoing, right? And it's a spiritual advent. It's the resurrections, right? Where some are resurrected in righteousness and others are resurrected in unrighteousness. And this cuts through family, tribe, clan, so forth and so on, right? It's between those who have chosen, right, and received the truth, right, to the glory of Abba Father and HaMoshiach, and those who have rejected the truth. Those who reject the truth, right, are under the spirit of the resurrection of unrighteousness. Those who receive the truth are under the spirit of righteousness and in the spirit of truth. This is why the Essenes and the Qumran, when they saw, even from such a time, they thought this war of the sons of God, right? You know, the sons of God versus, you know, versus the devils, you know, versus the human devils. This is where we're at right now, right? This is why you see this increasing lawlessness. Anyway, not to get too much into that, brothers and sisters, give thanks. Please support this ministry of His Majesty with the I prayer, with the I words, you know, words of support, donations, linking the information, tweeting out the information, sharing the information, co-laboring with I&I, signing up, getting a subscription to RastafariGroundation.com, also sharing the links there at Rastafari Groundation for the brothers and the sisters who contribute, you know, with their various calls, you know, their gifts, their talents, also linking other information from there, because this is an info war. This is an intel war, right? The thing that counters the counter intel is the intel, right? The true intelligence of the King of Kings in Christ. Amen. Amen. Shalom. Rastafari, this is Wyndham Yarden reporting. Who hath amained I and I report?